the normal Ghana emergency department will be like, Mami, Obano, Reno, and all that. But, and the patient will be like, shut up. I said, shut up. And you still have to be, okay, thank you. Thank you. Because sometimes you can get £40 per hour, £50, £60, and it's a whole lot. So don't be in Ghana and say that you are not coming to get you the ward. So he works on the ward.
Receiving patient from ED.
Hello, lovely people. Welcome to my YouTube channel. I am going to talk about my journey into the UK. Coming from Ghana, I've spent some months here in the UK and it's been good, I would say. So I'm just here to talk about how my journey has been so far. So stay with me and then let's go. Good. So now I have my friend here, Seth, but he will come in later to talk about his journey. So Seth, have a seat. Good. So back in Ghana, I was working as an emergency nurse in one of the Chag hospitals. Good. And well, I did a lot of things, served patients, but coming into the UK, it's been a whole lot of things. It's been a whole lot of things, you know, but then it's been good in some way. So I applied, I did interview, I came to the UK, I'm caring for patients, good patients, but then the money is not coming enough as I expected. But then, what can I do? So I have to just live with it, you know, because sometimes you can get £40 per hour, £50, £60, and it's a whole lot. So don't be in Ghana and say that you are not coming to the UK, you should. Or you can say to pursue US or Australia. Good. So it's been good. I'm working in the emergency department as a staff nurse, a band 5 nurse. And just all what I do is just to coordinate, triage patients, help patients. So we have band 1, band 2, band 3, band 4, all under the band 5 nurse. And so I being a band 5 nurse, I have a lot of responsibilities, caring for patients, delegating duties, attending to emergency cases that patients are coming in with, ensuring that they get to the ward. So he works on the ward. So Seth, tell us about how your journey has been so far.
It's been good. Let me say, you know, every journey starts with a step. As I will see, when the idea of coming to the UK came to mind, I had to just look for every opportunity to get myself in. Initially, I developed interest in going to the USA, but when I discovered that the process was going to take a year and more, I felt like, no, this is not my thing. I had to switch. And that is how the idea of coming to the UK came to mind. So I started pursuing IELTS. It was not a difficult journey though. I won't say it's easy writing IELTS, as most people know. I had to put in a lot of effort, study overnight. It's like, I took the IELTS as, I don't know how good, but I felt like I have to pass at all costs. Pass once and for all. Because I didn't know where I was going to get another money to re-register. Yeah, so I passed by God's grace and here I am. CBT, I wrote, I passed, and then I started doing some applications on certain specific sites that talked about UK job vacancies, and fortunately enough I had a hospital, I was permitted to come in here and also work, and now I'm working in the acute medical unit, AMU, receiving patients from ED.
But you see, one thing about coming into the UK is that when you come into the UK, it's not all that grocery. So it's not like you are coming and then because you're a band 5, you are just there and doing just the paperwork. No, it doesn't work like that in the UK. You are doing nursing. that's what you do when you come to the UK. So I was actually surprised when I came and in emergency department, the normal Ghana emergency department would be like, Mame, Obano, Reno, and all that. But here it is not like that. Here you have to, be a nightingale. You have to be a nightingale, and you have to be like, please, are you okay? And the patient will be like, shut up! I said shut up! And you still have to be, okay, thank you, thank you. So, but it's really good. It's really good. Yeah, but let's not Ghana. But then the tennis, it's interesting. We have a lot of things that we have get to know. So where we are working is at NHS as compared to the care home. I think we should do a video on care homes. But for NHS, it gives you that foundation for you to learn. So we have that preceptorship that when you qualify and you pass, you go through. So it's not like you are coming here with a Ghana knowledge to come and work. No. So they will give you what they have, and then you add your previous knowledge to it, and then that will groom you to become the perfect next. So that is it. And me being in the emergency department, there are a lot of things we do. We take bloods, cannulate, triage the patient, and all those things. Alongside sending patients to the ward, we also try as much as possible to handle acute on ward adult and acute on ward child. And this is some of the things that we do. And also the bell. This is something that every nurse hates in UK, the call bell. But then, well, you have to live with it.
You know, comparing the nursing in UK to that of Ghana, I would say, even though we are doing almost the same thing, but there are some advanced, I mean, procedures I never had a chance to see when I was working in Ghana. And another thing I also got to realize is that there's more training here, no matter the category you find yourself, okay? There are trainings each and every day, just trying to, I mean, they're just trying to equip you and embrace you with the modern style of nursing. And that is one thing I love. I mean, because you're always getting new knowledge each and every day. When you get to the ward, you know, comparing, I remember my first day on the ward, I mean, I was scared.
Woo!
It was like, things are quite different. Yeah. Like looking at the medications, looking at how, because I remember in Ghana, when you are prescribed, at least when a doctor prescribes infusion, like normal saline, you don't have to go and get another nurse to sign off before you set it up on the patient. But here, you have to go and look for somebody, another staff nurse, to sign, countersign, before you can set up the infusion, which is much more of time wasting. But I came to understand that, I mean, it's worth it, because sometimes it helps you avoid medication errors. If you're unable to spot a mistake in a prescription, your friend can, spot that. So that is one thing I also appreciate.
When I was in Ghana as an emergency nurse, all what I did was the doctor writes something and then you just follow it. But in UK, as an emergency nurse, you have that thing we call a PGD. So you can prescribe medications on your own. There are some medications that you can prescribe. So I can prescribe Senna, I can prescribe paracetamol, I can prescribe other medications for a patient that comes in, because I'm triaging the patient. And also the way we give blood transfusion in Ghana is different from how we do it here. The way we give medications is, as he said, is different. The way we do have some things like I've been trained on plastering, so not the plastering that we do on the wall, but then plastering as in applying a cast on a patient with fractures. So I've been trained to do that. There are some things that I've been trained that I never thought I would be able to do as a nurse, but in UK you are given that kind of competency for you to be trained and for you to get that competency. So for now, I said I have all my competencies achieved. The only thing left is, I don't know, other training courses and other opportunities, because they are, my world like this brings a lot of courses that I can use to further my career if I really want to. And in UK, if you want to progress, you don't have to go to school to bring a certificate to progress, but then you can just go and then apply for the position. If only you want and you think you can be able to do that band 6 or 7 thing that they do, if you think you can be able to do them, fine, you can apply, and if you get it, great.
And one thing I've also discovered, when I came here, is that, you see, there are some certain things we call competencies. You can't just go to the world and say you are checking somebody's blood pressure. I mean, being vital signs, as you used to know in Ghana. You can't go to the world and say you are going to set up an infusion, you are going to give a patient medication. You have to be signed off. We call it competencies. Mm. So you make sure that before you give, you do your drug rounds, you have been signed off and you have been declared competent to do that. Before you do your ECG, I mean, there are some procedures you wouldn't be allowed to do in Ghana, especially ECG, doing bladder scan, ECG, bladder
ND2
scan,
person.
ND2 person,
and
Ghana, we used to do ND2.
Yeah, Ghana, we used to do ND2, but not all nurses know how to pass an ND2. Let's be fair, my guys. Yeah, how many people in Ghana know how to?
ECG, I know.
But ECG, there are lots of people.
Only doctors, I know. Only doctors. That's what I know. I don't know. I stand to be graded. I only know it to be able to do ECG, you should be a doctor. Like, a doctor is certified to do ECG.
And do you know what? For instance, if a patient comes into Ghana, like the Ghana setting, with a query stroke, what we do is, oh, let's set up infusion and then we'll be doing it. Let's give the patient needs water. Let's give water for the patient to drink. But here, it doesn't work that way. So if a patient comes with stroke or query stroke, the first thing we do is let the patient go for a CT. And then we would not give the patient anything to drink until we've done a swallowing test. This I never knew when I was in Ghana, until I came here to know that we have to do swallowing tests.
Yeah, and then
for people with
one thing
stroke,
I remember
before
is,
we give them, yeah. And I think it's good, you know.
Yeah, there's more of teamwork on the ward. You see, when you go to the ward, it's not you just the nurse. We have doctors, we have physiotherapists, we have diabetic nurse, we have dietitians, speech and language therapists. I mean, everybody is coming in. So if a patient comes, let's say stroke, now. The idea is, who should you refer this patient to the stroke nurse? If a patient comes with diabetes, who should you refer this patient? So you'll be on the ward caring for the patient. It's like, you see the diabetes nurse coming, you see the stroke nurse, physiotherapist, everybody is coming to look after a patient. So it's more of teamwork. So at the end of the day, the nurse is the center of whatever is happening. Whatever plan the physiotherapist right, whatever plan the doctor right, whatever plan the diabetes nurse right, is the responsibility of the nurse to make sure that that is executed. So it's like you are the center of a bigger team. And to me, I didn't see that in Ghana. It's much more of you and your colleagues, and then the doctor. Yeah, you see a physiotherapist coming.
I think in Ghana, when somebody needs to do an endoscopy, or endoscopy is incredible behind stroke ward, but then let's say the patient needs an MRI or anything like that, or imagery, things like that. In Ghana, we have to tell mommy, go to so and so, and we'll give you a date for you to go. If you don't have money, but on the other side, these are the things that we have learned, and a whole lot, because of time, we can't go deeper into it. But then, for those in Ghana, there are lots of things that I can say we've learned that we brought here.
Yeah.
For instance, in Ghana, there are some medications that we can give as a bolus, as a push. Here, you have to use a whole lot of channels to do it. They also, if you go to the medication protocol for administration, we have the Ghana principle where you can give something like ondansetron. You can just give it as a push and give it straight away. But it's there.
Did you have an
ondansetron? Ghana, they don't have ondansetron, but yes. But here, metoclopramide says that you can mix or you can give directly. So definitely, the same Ghana principle we can use and then give the patient promethazine or Ghana cyclizine. Yeah, here cyclizine you have to mix it in a 50 ml bag of normal saline.
The cyclizine is an antiemetic.
Yeah, so you can in Ghana we do that, and also in Ghana we care for patients a lot. We really assist the patient, carry them and do all that, but here we give that patient the independent, and Ghana nurses are really caring. And so when you bring that caring attitude to the UK and the foreign people, when they see you doing exhibiting this kind of things, traits, they are really happy, and it takes them So it's really good. So there are a lot of things we've learned from Ghana coming here. And there are a lot of things we've learned here as a nurse registered.
So what I would say is that if you did nursing in Ghana, don't say you can't survive as a nurse in the UK. Because even though we almost run the same shifts, except that there's a little, different. Because you go for 9 shifts, Ghana, you have 9 shifts. If you are here for the money, the whatever purpose for which you are coming here, you can achieve it, because Ghana, we've done a lot. And once we come here, we don't struggle. Every Ghanaian here is working hard, trying to possibly take extra shifts so that at least you'll be able to meet up to the standard or the reason for which he or she came here. So,
A lot of people keep asking about, especially for those that are already in UK, they keep asking, how am I going to get this competency? How am I going to get this competency? I've been here for so long, I can't get this competency. You need to speak to your line manager. You need to speak to them for them to tell you and for them to show you the process of getting it. For instance, if you don't know how, if you're registered next until now, and maybe you arrested your penis in for about a month and you can't give IV medication, speak to your line manager. Let them book you for training and let them train you. You know how to give IV medication because you were trained in Ghana. But here, the way they do it, if you learn it, you will see the difference. Then, so that you don't do things contrarily. So that you don't do things that are not in the right way. That's what I'm trying to mean. So, get your competencies. Speak to your line managers. Tell them about your problems. If they are not able to help you, speak to the one that brought you to the hospital. Speak to them. Speak to anyone. Talk about it. Else, you'll be stagnant.
The hospital you are working with has been very supportive in it, because I remember when we came to the UK, we were quarantined for about two weeks. Yeah. And right after our quarantine period was due, I think we had... I mean, we are giving some, how do I call it, is it a mentor or somebody to actually I don't know what word to use, to serve as a tour guide, to coach us, to probably show us what you need to do, what you need to get. And I remember when we came out, we had to get somebody to lead us to get our BPR, biometric, so from there, when you go to the world, you have a mentor, somebody who will be showing you around. I mean, this is how we do this. You must do it this way. I mean, if I have any problem, I have somebody to talk to. And for me, my world has been very supportive in a way, because, as I said, things are, when I go to the world, I realize that things were totally different from where I'm coming from. I mean, they have different policies for medication. They have different equipment to use. For example, if you want to give blood, I don't know, at our place, when we are giving the blood, we must run it through an infusion pump. It's not done so in Ghana. You just set it up and then, yeah, you must run it through an infusion pump.
You can run it through an infusion pump, or you can, in emergency department, we have three ways of doing it. Either we run it through an emergency infusion pump, we have the infusion pump, or we run it through something we call level one rapid infuser. That's if in case the patient came in with trauma and the patient is really bleeding out, we need to transfuse. And with this one, we have to, if in case we have to transfuse like 2 units or 3 units of blood, we can transfuse at the same time using a rapid infuser. If some say it's not good, others say it's good, I'll leave it to AMU. And then you can give it using the normal tube. I prefer to use the normal blood giving set tube to administer my medications. Yeah. I don't like using the syringe pump, the infusion pump, because it will delay. And it's good because it will prompt you in case the blood is not flowing. But, well, I like the Ghana thing.
Yeah, because, you know, once you get to the world, as I said, you can't do certain procedures. Even we know in Ghana, most Ghanaian nurses are good at cannulation. But no matter how good you are, when you get to the world and you have not been signed off, or you have not been deemed competent, you can't cannulate. No matter how good or how excellent you are in cannulation. So you just have to make sure that is done. Now, turning that to the blood transfusion, in my world, you just have to, I mean, we are told to give blood through an infusion pump. And one of the reasons is, sometimes, you know, the blood is supposed to, you can give it within the space of 4 hours or probably 3 hours. So, it might happen that your cannula is probably, is well fitted, but the patient in a way has bent the hand. Now, it's blocked, and that the blood will not be flowing. So the machine or the infusion pump can prompt you. So it's one of the reasons why we prefer to give blood through an infusion pump, so that in case there's any issue with the line or the cannulation, the machine can beep and then we know that there's a problem. So we just want to give the blood within that specified period, because the protocol says that if you are unable to give the blood within that specified period, no matter how much is left, I mean, you can't continue the transfusion. Yeah, so that is why we have been told to give through an infusion pump. And then, I mean, there are a lot of training going on. Things keep on coming every day, sometimes around the world. And then we have, is it practice development nurses? Yeah, they are made to educate us. Let's make sure that we are fitting in, I mean, fitting in the system. Because as I said, things are quite different. Even though you're a nurse, you might have nursed for so many years, 15 years in Ghana.
So before we leave, I just want to leave this to our new cohort or nurses that are currently in the UK and those aspiring to become nurses in the UK. When you come to UK and you begin to work, please, please, please be careful. Be careful of what we call the pain. Be careful because your pain can be taken away from you and then your life in UK will be useless. This is because, no, Seth, let's say this. This is because,
the thing is that the most scariest word in the UK is your pain. You lose your pain and then
dentist. The thing is that if you are not careful, for instance, if I'm trying to bring a point, for instance, if you come into the UK, Ghana, we were trained that Oko Woda, na Oye Niwa, na Moye Bibia She, na Afriwaka Ten Sister, Mame Suminye Bie. But here you can know it doesn't matter. If you have not been trained to do a specific task, don't do it. Don't do it because if something happens, you can lose your pain.
Especially if you have the pain. But if, one thing people don't know is that once you get to the UK, maybe you might have written your IELTS and then CBT. Now once you get here, you are not a certified registered nurse. You are a pre-registered nurse until you write your OSCE pass, and then the UKNMC will issue you a PIN. Now, once you are pre-registered nurse, you are working under somebody. So, if you do a procedure and probably maybe there's a problem, the person will be held accountable. And most times, people wouldn't, I mean, the mentor or whoever you are working wouldn't want you to, or wouldn't want to put his PIN at risk. So, he won't let you do some of the procedures. You just observe. There are some who are so genuine and are willing to help. They will just observe you do it. So it depends on who you are getting. Some will just, you just be walking about, just trying to observe things. Yeah, until you get your pin, you become independent, and there you are responsible for whatever you do. So you just have to be careful. If you have not been signed off, you might have the pin, but if you have not been signed off as competent to do a procedure,
Don't try it.
Because, as I said, there are two scariest words in the UK. You lose your pin, and then I'll detest, you'll be detest. So, when you say detest is more like reporting an incident. Let's say when you go to the ward and then you fail to check a patient's observations. Yeah, we call it observation, but Ghana, we are known to it as vital signs. Yeah. And let's say, the next nurse is taking the shift. If he or she thinks, what you've done
will affect the patient negatively and may affect the nurse, but he or she will be prone to day test. For instance, as you were saying, let's say that I have taken up a ward and there's a patient that needs to go for an x-ray, but then the time the doctor requested the x-ray was like 5 hours ago and the nurse couldn't allow the patient to go and nothing was documented. The reason wasn't documented. If I'm coming to take over, I have to day test because I have to report the incident to my managers, to the entire managers, for them to see what he has done and for them to investigate him and explain.
And that is to make sure that you are not at fault. It's not your fault that procedure wasn't done. It's the nurse who handed over to you. So that's the general. So most times, just have to make sure that
it can be anything.
But I can't remember, there was this, when I went to the ward, there was this nurse who was supposed to give, what is it called? Is it morphine? True, the patient has been declared end of life, and she was supposed to give morphine through the syringe pump. That's the syringe pump. The syringe
the
driver.
Through
the syringe driver. And one thing that happened was that I think she wasn't aware, but most of the time when the doctors prescribe, there are some that will come and tell you that I prescribe this medication so you can give to the patient. Others will just write on the prescription chart and then go. So if you don't take the prescription chart,
it happens in emergency department.
Yeah, then look at what has been prescribed. You end up not giving that medication. And when the nurse who is taking over from you comes, she might not be happy. And to save herself from losing her pain, she would want to detest you or just report the incident. So that when there's any issue, she won't be the person responsible, or she won't be the person to be called. So one of the scariest words is dictation. That is why you just have to make sure that you are doing things right. And if there's something you didn't do or you couldn't do, just make sure you hand over. And because of this, I couldn't do this.
Yeah.
So
yeah. And if you don't know anything, please ask.
That's important.
If you don't know anything, please ask.
Ask questions.
Please ask
questions. No foolish question.
There is no foolish question. Keep asking. Get a notebook as a newly registered nurse who have passed you also. Get a notebook. Ask questions.
I wish, right? I could show my notes. When I went to the ward for the first time, I bought a book. There were some medication. In fact, the 90% of the medication I had not seen in Ghana. So I had to write them in my book. Whatever procedure, whatever way, like whatever condition, I have to write them in my book. So it's, I mean, your first month or 2 months on the ward is like a learning curve. You are learning from different sectors because there are new medications.
And immediately you become a registered nurse, you are on preceptorship. Know that you are on a preceptorship. You are to ask questions. So ask any question, because don't feel shy to ask a question, because at the end of the day, if you are done with that period of preceptorship, you are now so-called a responsible, independent nurse.
Yeah.
And you need to do something, and you are now asking. People would have it in mind that, and again, you were born. What's not happening based in 2 years? So please, this is the time for you to ask questions.
So once you are ask questions, like, don't spend about a year, 2 years, and still, I mean, you can't know everything. There are some things you just have to ask, yeah, but not those common things that you are expected to know within the space of, let's say, 2 months or, yeah. But in all, you know, if you are not sure of anything, ask questions. I mean, there's no stupid question. If the person fails to answer, fine. If he or she doesn't answer, I mean, you can move on to a different person.
And also, don't forget to go for your break. This is very important. Go for your break. Because I think, there's something.
What is break? In Ghana, you don't go for break. What happens here is when you are going for a 12-hour shift, especially if you are going for a night shift, you have 1 hour break. Okay, if you are going for a long day, like I think it's still 12 hours, you have 1 hour break. So you can probably divide that into two, half an hour, depending on how you want to. Yeah, but I think that's not so in Ghana. It's no break. So that's what happens. You have an hour break, especially if you are going for an early shift. I think it's just 30 minutes. Yeah, half an hour break. So, but sometimes the world is too busy to the point that you even forget you have to go for break.
But
whichever way
you
should go for a break. Thank you very much for watching this video. See you in our next video.